conversation. We're talking financial literacy. You ain't even got to turn me down, sis. Let's turn them up. Near me, I want you to make your way this way. We're about to get into a conversation with the one and only Aaliyah Duah. Come on, Aaliyah. We're talking all things financial literacy right here. This is the youngest in the game. We gotta cut that mic on.
Yeah.
We're talking one of the biggest, craziest topics. It's really not that taboo, but you know, we don't like to talk money all the time, right? It can be a little uncomfortable, but let's just get into the fit real quick. Can I just acknowledge the cream?
Yeah, all cream today.
Full cream.
Yeah, no, all cream. All
if
cream.
Anybody puts their face on this, I will run down for you. All right, let's have a seat. You pick wherever you want to go. Y'all feeling good? Living better? Y'all make sure if you post it, tell them where they can tag you real quick.
Financial Revolution. Right, so financial and then revolution with two N's.
Yes. All right, so let's get into it. You are the CEO and founder of Financial Revolution. For the people who are not familiar with your brand, your company, tell us a little bit about it.
So my name is Aaliyah Duah. I'm 20 years old. I just recently graduated from Virginia State University. I have a degree. Thank you so much. I have a degree in business management, and I started Financial Revolution when I was 16, 17 years old, a sophomore in college during the pandemic. And my whole goal is to teach financial literacy and entrepreneurship to people in my demographic between the ages of 8 to 25, because I think that we don't learn about this at all. And I think I could put some swag into it, make it look cool, and then make us learn about investing, right? Make us learn about, all right, how can we build wealth and get fly at the same time?
I know that's right. Y'all feeling fly?
Y'all be feeling fly. I need some energy for the crowd. Y'all not giving me energy. Like, what's up, y'all? What's up?
So you just said you got into this at 16. Why? Because for me, people ask me all the time, well, why do you MC? Well, I wasn't good at math or science. So did you get A's in math? Like, help me.
I mean, I was always a good student, but it wasn't really school, you know? It was during the pandemic, I had a time to really sit and reflect. Like, none of us could go outside, none of us could do anything. So all the sneakers I had, all the shoes I had, all the things that I valued and I thought was important, it meant nothing, nothing. What really meant something was my family, my health, right? What can I bring to the table? And I realized at that time, it wasn't much that I could do. So that's when I started just reading things that could shift my mindset. So I was reading like Rich Dad, Poor Dad, Think and Grow Rich. And then when I was doing that, you know, your mindset starts to shift. And I was like, oh, wait, financial literacy, like, I never learned about this before. And that's when I was like, all right, telling my friends, like, yo, we can go put our money into this and it's gonna grow, and then we can have this much money, we can be rich and this and this and that. And then I was just like, nah, I just can't tell my friends, I gotta tell the world.
So exposure is a really big thing for us, and especially young black kids. Who was the person or people that exposed you to even Rich Dad, Poor Dad? Because at 16, I can guarantee I was reading The Hunger Games and not Rich Dad, Poor Dad.
All right, so one, my mom is in here. Where's my mom?
Mama Jua?
My mom's right here. So hey. Everybody give it up for my mom, right?
With the flyest pants on.
Yeah, so my mom is in here. So both of my parents are entrepreneurs. So I grew up around entrepreneurship. So my mom used to literally take me to like flea markets with her. And I used to be out there like trying to sell her stuff for her business. And I was like the youngest out there. And that's when I first learned like, oh, you could make $1,000 in a day. So that right there was already like shifting my mindset. Cause I'm like, all right, I'm working for myself. Well, I'm working for my mom. But my mom working for herself and she making this much money in a day, I want to do this. So I always knew I wanted to be an entrepreneur. I just didn't know like what I wanted to do. Like I wanted to have an impact. So Rich Dad, Poor Dad actually came into my life during a Christmas gift. It was a Christmas gift from my brother actually. And he was like, you need to read this book. And I'm an executor, so I'm like, all right, I'm gonna read it. What is this about? And then it was just up from there.
I kid you not. The books I was giving and the books you were giving say a lot. So get your kid, Rich Dad Poor Dad. Do you have a book coming?
Yes, I have a book out and I have another one on the way. Yes.
So definitely clap that up.
Appreciate that. Thank you.
And also, just in your journey, because like you said, you're 20 years old, do you have an Aaliyah's reading list?
Oh, yeah, of course. I could, like, send it out to Aaliyah, but, yeah, I have, like, my top, like, I'll say my top five. So, of course, Rich Dad, Poor Dad, Think and Grow Rich, a book that a lot of people don't know about, but it's called The Wealth Choice, right? It's by Napoleon Hill. That right there, it talks about all the black people who built wealth. Right, without like being in media, entertainment. Sorry, you go.
Wait a second.
You
were
invested. Okay. You were invested. I'm sorry.
We're gonna be friends after this.
Media entertainment is still good. Media entertainment is still good. But yeah, so what? The Wealth Choice, yes. The Wealth Choice by Napoleon Hill. And I also like mindset books, right? So we have how Rich People Think, right? And then my last one I will give to y'all is my book, The Blueprint for Investing Volume 1. And that teaches you how to actually get started investing in the stock market.
Okay.
The Blueprint for Investing Volume 1. And I have a booth out there if y'all want to come get the book.
Say the booth number.
516. I'm so sorry. 516.
So y'all got to check out the booth. But I'm glad that you ended there, because the big question is, how do I get started? And for a lot of people here, I'm actually one of those, their investment is buying the ticket to come here. And I don't think we put that into perspective when it comes to different styles of investing. We always think stock market. We think, well, I go on cruises, so maybe I should buy into this. But the room right here is an investment. Amen. So tell me a little bit about, what was your first investment? Like, what made you say, let's keep this going?
All right, so I'm not sure if y'all remember the Forex thing that was happening all over social media?
Yeah. You was posting flyers and outfits too?
Yeah, I was one of those. I was one of those, right? So I actually started off with Forex. And I would say that right there kind of put me around like people that have helped me change my mindset. I'm gonna tell you guys something really important. The people you hang around every day, the people that you're talking to, the things that you're watching, the things that you're listening to and is entering your mind, garbage in, garbage out. So y'all gotta make sure that y'all are filtering the people that you hang around. You can't say that you want a new lifestyle but keep the old people around. You know what I'm saying? That got the same mindset. That doesn't mean you can't love them. That doesn't mean you can't like, you know, hang out with them. It just means you have to filter, you know, filter their access to you, because what they're talking about, their conversations and all that stuff, that's what you are engaging in. So if you want better for yourself, you have to engage in better, right? That's how you're going to shift the mindset. So after you leave here and you meet these wonderful people, now the application applies, right? So you have to actually go and do something, right? So put some action into your thoughts, you know what I'm saying?
And just to follow up on that, how many of y'all are actually really good at following up after you meet somebody? There's not enough.
Y'all didn't raise your hand. Y'all sleeping? What's going on?
And then you just get scrolling on Instagram one day and you're like, why do I follow this person? Where do I know them from? It's because we didn't follow up. So can we set a goal real quick?
Let's set a goal.
So for investment sake, can we give the people a number of investments, meaning connections in here, that they should make before they leave the weekend? It's a challenge.
Yes. So y'all know how we do those social media challenges where you at a party, how many people you want to meet and all things like that? Let's do a business challenge, right? So let's say you meet five people that you could connect with. Figure out a way that you can add value to those people. Don't figure out a way how they can add value to you, right? They always say that the most successful people in life, they add value to others, right? So figure out, no matter, it could be something as simple as I can, you know, help you post on social media or whatever, you know, whatever you feel like your talent is, figure that out and say, all right, I can do this for this person, I can do that for that person, right? And that's what's going to take you far, because people are going to start seeing your value. They're going to say, yeah, I need this person around me because they are valuable. You always want to be a value add, okay?
And so I think that's number one for me.
Thank you, I appreciate that. You're
a star.
Thank you so much, I appreciate that.
You're welcome. So I think that's step number one for me, is looking at what I already have around me as my first investment. People get scared when money is involved. I think we all know that. You leave the house, you spend $100, but that $100 could have went where? In a savings account. Be for real, y'all know. So what is step two? Now that we're tapping into money, how do you get started?
So, one, I would say, we got the goal, now you gotta be consistent, right? So a lot of times, How many of you guys are the ones when the new year starts, y'all got all these goals, and then by January 4th, y'all ready quit? I give y'all 4 days, y'all ready quit. Be honest, how many of you guys are like that, right? So I would say do something that holds yourself accountable, right? Find yourself an accountability partner. Like, I would literally go on some, like, sacrifices where I say, I'm not doing this until I accomplish this goal, right? So let something that you really love doing, take that away from yourself, and then say, all right, when I accomplish this, I can do that, right? Or now that I shifted my mindset, when I accomplish something, I say, you know what, I'm going to go give me a new investment. Now that's training my mind to value investing more than just spending my money on, like, stuff that don't really value anything or mean anything to me.
Are you sure you're 20?
I'm sure.
Right, because the level of mental toughness this takes in order to get to the next thing is really, really insane for me. And that's where I get stuck. It's like, okay, well, I'm not going to eat this today. And then tomorrow comes, I said I wasn't eating that today.
All right, so, but you got to shift your mindset, right? Because
yes.
I have that same problem too. But this is what I do. I'll say, you know what? What's harder? Like, let's say if I want to lose weight, right? If I eat this cookie and I keep eating a cookie, I'm just gonna keep gaining weight. Now it's gonna be harder for me to lose that weight that I just gained again, right? So if you say that if I keep doing something that doesn't work for me, I'm just putting myself in a deeper hole that's gonna take me harder to get out. So if I stop here, right, and I give myself time and I give myself grace and I learn from here, then it's gonna be a little bit more easier. But if I keep falling into the hole, I'm gonna just get more deeper. You know what I'm saying? So we gotta start shifting the way that we look at into life, right? We gotta look at it and say, you know what? Let me do this with my money because I keep getting myself in this financial situation that I don't like. I need to stop. You know what I'm saying? Like, figure out what's harder in life, being broke, right, or being disciplined. You know what I'm saying?
So I want to get into, you said you just graduated. Congratulations.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much.
So in doing this while you're in college, because my college path was a little bit different. Of course, I was on campus, but I was never actually there because I was out here working, trying to make sure I was on stages, getting jobs, doing all the things. So I can imagine if I had a hard time, what was it like trying to have conversations with people whose minds just are not even in the space to receive, trying to invest right now? We're trying to go to the parties. How do you find your tribe? And are they knocking on the door now?
Yeah, so one thing my dad told me, he was like, the teacher will come when a student is ready, right? So I never like try to force myself onto people or force my mindset onto people. I just give people like a alternative, right? Another way to think about situations. And like, my goal is to make, I use psychology, it's reverse psychology, it's just science. I make what I do look so cool to the point where people feel like they gotta be tapped in. That's it. When you make what you're doing look cool, people are gonna wanna be around you. Then when they're around you, they're already shifting their mindset because I'm into certain things, I'm doing certain things. You're gonna find me at the party, but before the party, you're gonna find me doing a financial literacy workshop. You know what I'm saying? So it's like, all right, if Aaliyah could do both, I could do both. You know what I'm saying? So it's just like, whatever business ideas that you have, right? Think about all the trends that we follow. Everything is just a trend. Like Barbie, look at Barbie. Barbie got everyone to go to that movie and wear pink.
I was one.
Think about it. Everybody went to the movies wearing pink. So if you can get that same psychology with your business, right, then you won't be successful. That's how I look at it. I'm like, all right, how can I get what I'm doing so popping on my campus that like it's gonna be like, I wanna be tapped in with Aaliyah. You know what I'm saying? So it's like, at one point, like, I had like a lot of people on my campus wearing my brand and stuff like that, just so that people can see it. It's always on their mind. It's always like, nah, I got to tap in with Financial Revolution, or I got to tap in with Aaliyah. You know what I'm saying? Make what you're doing look cool, seem cool. It's the thing that you need to be doing. And it's going to mess with people's minds because they're going to get FOMO and feel like, ah, I'm missing out. I got to be a part of this movement.
So I want to shift the conversation just a little bit to the conversation with parents and their kids, because you are the voice of the youth. How many parents do I have in the audience? How many aunties and uncles do I have in the audience?
All right.
How many big brothers and big sisters do I have in the audience?
All right. Clap it up for yourselves. Y'all doing a wonderful role. Let's
do it. And how many people just know somebody with some kids? Okay, we all do. Thank you. So in having those conversations, you're talking to the teens. Do you ever find it where the teen takes what you've given them back to their parents? And what does that shift look like?
Oh, man. Parents. Right? I think, you know, as parents, we have not we, I'm not a parent, sorry. I think as parents, right, you have to realize the role that you play in your child's life, right? So what you do, not what you say, but what you do is going to reflect on your child's actions. You know what I'm saying? So if you're the type of person who's saying, save your money, but your child never sees you doing that, they not going to save their money. You know what I'm saying? If you're the type to saying like, oh, I want to build wealth, I'm going to do that, but your child don't see it, 9 times out of 10, your child's not going to do it, right? And you got two types of kids. You got kids who's going to follow, or you got kids who's like, nah, I see my parent go through so much that I don't want this for myself, right? So you got to really like figure out, okay, I have to do this not just for me, because I have somebody watching. I have a young adult. I have somebody who's growing up in my household, and they're watching what I do, right? So you have to better your finances because you have another kid who's going to be depending on your mindset on the way that they live, right? So I always tell my students, the way that you live right now is based off of the choices that your parents made at your age. Think about that, right? The way that we live is based off of some of the choices that our parents made. So if you're a parent, you got to make the right choices.
Hold on, I'm gonna just push pause for 2 seconds because we got people walking by who don't even know who you are right now. Yo, we got the one and only Aaliyah Duah on the stage.
I appreciate y'all. Thank you.
20 years old, voice of the youth. I know she went 20. God, I know, me too. 20 years old, knows her stuff. You are just.
Thank you.
Yeah, so we were talking books earlier, and my cousin, she's actually here. So my cousin Paige Cherie is on the main stage.
Oh, nice.
So it's a family affair.
Nice.
Her sister actually has a children's financial literacy book called Savannah's Savings Jar.
Oh, I heard about that. Yes.
That's the family.
Yes, nice.
So we're trying to make talking finance, talking dollars, talking money fun for kids. What is your hooker?
A lot of different things. I speak the language of my generation, if that makes sense, right? So I'm like all into like all the new words. I'm like, what's good, y'all? You know what I'm saying? I put some like swag into it, right? When I'm in a classroom, I'm not wearing a suit, right? I'm coming in my Jordans, my Nike Tech, my hoodie, you know what I'm saying? Because you believe it or not, that right there is relatable. So it's like, wow, you dress the way I dress. You come from where I come from. You speak the way I speak, right? But then you're smart. You're intelligent. I look up to that. I want to be like that when I grow up. You know what I'm saying? Right? So it's like when you put a swag behind it, when you put like the relatability factor behind it, that's something that you can't take away. Versus sometimes when you have, I used to like be in class and they'll bring speakers. You're bringing a 40-year-old white man. No offense, but it's just like, I can't relate to you.
Dog, I was a high school substitute teacher at 23 years old. The amount of times I was asked, do you want some nachos?
Right?
I don't want it. But also, to your point, to show up and to try to relate to a young child, let alone a young person, sets the stage for them to listen even sooner.
Exactly.
So I want to go back to the parent-child relationship again because I think that's super important. My parents, I don't remember growing up having conversations about your savings account or having an investment account or, your retirement account. Did you set that up or did your parents have that set up for you? Do you have conversations around that? What is that like?
I'll be honest. No, I didn't have that set up for me. But my dad is a real estate investor. So at least I saw it. I didn't have anything set up, but I saw it. And also, like, let's say I wanted some sneakers, right? And let's say I want some Jordans. My dad would be like, do you even know the owner of Nike? And in my head, I would be like, no, that does not matter. I just want the sneakers. But then growing up, I didn't know how that was really instilling something into me, right? Because now it's like, I know the owner of Nike. I know what he stands for. I know what he does. You know what I'm saying? Like, I know Nike stock. You know what I'm saying? And to another person, they're looking at Nike as like just from a consumer standpoint, but now that I get to look at it from like an investor mindset, right? Of like, all right, the different shifts in the mindset. And I think like that's what's really important. Don't just, you know, pour into your kid to where they look good on the outside. Really make sure that they look good on the inside and like their mindset is good, making sure that they understand what's going on. You know what I'm saying? And that's why it's even more important as parents that you understand, because you can't teach what you don't know. You know what I'm saying? And even if you don't know something, you want your child to be better than you, right? So you make sure that you put your child in programs that wasn't even provided for you. You know what I'm saying? Because at least if you don't know, you a child note, and then he or she could put you onto some game, and then y'all growing together. You know what I'm saying?
You can't teach what you don't know. It's super important and impactful to me because last December, I got the opportunity to go over to South Africa. Nice. And I was hesitant to go because it was something I had never seen my parents do, let alone my grandparents. Nobody had seen it. It's the place that we talk about. We want to go see where our ancestors were, etc. You got to take teens, young adults, over to Africa. Y'all, this is not any small feat. What? How many kids? Talk a little bit about it, and why Africa?
So I'm from Ghana, West Africa, and I went in 2019 when I was 16 years old. When I first went, it was like a change in my mindset. Like, I was like, wow, this is where I'm from. Like, they told us it's just straight dirt, nothing. As soon as I got off of out of the airport, the first thing I saw was a Mercedes-Benz dealership. And I'm like, they got this in Africa? You know what I'm saying? So from right there and, like, just all the different activities I was doing, my mindset was just shifting. Then fast forward in 2022, I actually got to go to Africa for free for a fellowship. And during that fellowship, I was just like, wow, this was an amazing opportunity. Like, everything paid for, like, every single thing. And when I went, I was basically like, I want to be able to provide this experience to other people. Like, whatever I go through in life, right, good, like, the good stuff, I always want to make sure that somebody else can feel the same goodness that I felt. And that's when I was like, all right, I don't got the money right now, but I got a resource. So at my HBCU,
say that again.
I don't got the money right now, but I got the resource.
That's the bar. Because we stop ourselves when we don't have that.
Yes.
Sorry, keep going.
Yes. So at my HBCU, I was in the student government, so I was the executive vice president. And my president asked me, like, Aaliyah, what's one thing that we can do that can really, like, set a legacy and, like, change the game? I said, we got to take kids to Africa. Like, what if Virginia State University takes students to Africa every single year where they're learning about their roots? They're going to places where their ancestors were. They're learning about themselves. They're seeing things in a different. They're going to change their mindset. So we went and we sat with our president and we created a whole, like, pitch deck. We did the idea. We was on top of him. We stayed consistent. And we took 22 people to Africa. It was like 6 faculty members and like 14 students. And it's going to be an annual thing that it happens every single year where students and faculty members get to go to Africa. I appreciate y'all.
I get so excited when I come across pioneers.
Thank you.
And I don't know if you've been called that yet. But you are truly pioneering something so much bigger than yourself. So when people ask, do you know the owner of Jordan? No. Do you know who kicked off going to Africa at Virginia State University?
Thank you.
At not even 20. What was it, like 18, 17?
I was 19 when I was talking about it, but I was 20 when it happened.
But the thing is, you started at a team. We in our 20-somethings now. That's phenomenal. And also, too, just to stay on the Africa tip, I don't think that we give Africa enough credit because we're always shown in commercials that it's this place that doesn't have much of anything and we're poor and all this stuff. But the way that we can invest over there to see our dollars go further, the businesses that we can create, and also giving other opportunities to people over there who don't have the resources that we have.
Exactly.
I'll never forget in December, I was challenged by an African, because they call us Black Americans. he said, do I recognize my Black American privilege?
What did you say to that?
I said, I have privilege? He said, yeah, first things first, you look like us, but you don't look like us. The next thing is, do you realize that your $1 supersedes ours by an exponential amount? So what we're able to do by even bringing our presence over there is not only show them the possibilities, but give them hope.
Exactly.
So I'm just interested to know what is next for Aaliyah Duah.
Right now I'm building out a community, right? And I'm really focusing on, like, creating systems that I can use to really help change my generation and our mindset and bring in everything that we enjoy doing, whether it's music, whether it is having fun parties, whatever, bringing all of that into one system where I'm mixing the education and the fun so that we really learning, but we having fun at the same time.
It's giving there's a dictionary coming where you're going to be able to give it to the parents to talk to their kids.
Oh yeah, I do have a financial literacy game.
How can we find it?
So if you go on my website, financialrevolution.com, if you go to my mom right there, she got all my information. Financialrevolution.com, I have a link to like every single thing that I do. And just follow me on Instagram, because I do a lot of things like on Instagram, and you'll stay in tune with all the stuff I do.
Can we see the book?
Oh yeah, I can see the book. Yeah, I can see the book. Right, so the book is a workbook, and I also have I'm giving away free financial planners. You're seeing that QR code right there. So this is the book. It gives you a step-by-step guide on how to get started investing in the stock market. I'll show it, but I'll make sure y'all get to go touch it and stuff like that when I get down here, so y'all can go see it.
Now we all understand why she chose to wear this cream white situation, because it's the cleanest, meanest. You're just the baddest in the game.
Thank you. My mom's saying I'm a Delta, but yeah, crimson and cream. Yeah.
Well, and there it is. Oh, there's some more. We got some Greek in the building. Giving those sticks. All right, y'all. So we're gonna wrap it up right here. If y'all have questions, y'all meet Aaliyah. Can they ask you some questions down at the front?
Yeah, of course.
Okay,
of course.
Come to the booth. What's
516? Sorry, I don't know.
516. Make sure y'all head over. Get your financial planner. Get the book, the blueprint for investing. Volume 1.
Volume 2
is on the way.
On the way.
I know that's right. Thank you guys for checking in.
I appreciate you.
Thank you so much. InvestFest Day 1 is underway. Y'all stick around. Make sure you shop. Check out our booths, 516. And I'm about to head back over to the Fidelity stage, so y'all can catch me there.
All right, let's get it, y'all.